Hello everyone, this is Shantanu Mukherjee. Today, May 2nd, 2021, happens to be the birth centenary of iconic filmmaker and a great humanist, Satyajit Ray. Unfortunately, we have not seen much on this centenary year as we have seen in other legends. So I thought this is a good opportunity to share my thoughts on him, Satyajit Ray, lest he is erased from our memories and the incoming generation forgets about him. It's a small reminder to the Gen Next. Satyajit Ray, popularly known as Manikda, as I have told, was born 100 years ago today. And he had a very illustrious lineage to be proud upon. His grandfather, paternal grandfather, Upendra Kishore Rai Chaudhary, was born 1863. That is, he was exactly a contemporary of Swami Vivekananda, born the same year. And he was born in what Mymensingh, which is a district in Bangladesh today. Then it was part of Bengal. And there's a place known as Kishore Ganj. He was one of, Upendra Kishore Rai Chaudhary was one of the pioneers of Brahmo movement, which was all pervasive then in the Bengal Renasa movement, which was sweeping all across Bengal while the British were ruling us. The Ramakrishna movement, the Christianity, the Arya Samaj and everything. So he took a pioneering lead in sort of propagating Brahmo. Other than this, Upendra Kishore, who dropped Rai Chaudhary, Chaudhary later being only Rai, that is how Satyajit Ray remains only Ray, was a prolific writer. It is amazing to see Upendra Kishore having written books on almost every subject. Like for example, he had written Puranic tales, our old legendary tales, say Shakuntala, Raja Dushyant, Nal Damayanti, Savitri Satvan. Then we find that he has written in verse form children's Ramayana, children's Mahabharat. Then a lot of, say for example, on wildlife, he is writing on tarantula the spider, on dinosaur, on German shepherd dogs and their companionship with the army. Anyway, in nutshell, he was a great writer covering a wide spectrum of things of interest, which is not really found among people of that age. And in a very short period, he had accomplished that. He died, unfortunately, in 1915, rather early. His son, Satyajit Ray's father, Sukumar Ray, was born in 1887. He also died early, in only 1923, when Satyajit was only 2 years old. Sukumar Ray again had inherited qualities of his father. This is amazing. He was a great writer, a humorist, a satirist, interested in printing technology, went to England, had his education, came back, started a magazine called Sandesh, and which carried humor, satirical articles, very popular. He also carried forward the tenets of the Brahmo movement in Bengal and even in beyond. Interestingly, he opened a club which was known as the Monday Club, where the likes of P.C. Mahalanobis, Jagdish Chandra Basu, Tagore and everybody, they assembled this to have an intellectual interaction and brainstorming on a variety of issues, maybe that ouster of British, how to give it. But my main focus was on his satirical pieces. Many of you might know his iconic works, which is in Bangla, of course, which is Abol Tabol. This is the number one. Abol Tabol means nonsensical rhymes. Then Hojo Boro Law. Then Pagla Dashu, that is, Dashu is a character, Pagla Dashu Mad, which were extremely popular in those days, in the early 20th century. Well, his wife was Suprabha Devi, and as I told you, he left the world in 1923, leaving Satyajit into the guardianship of Suprabha, his wife, who was also a Brahmo. Her paternal grandfather was another illustrious man, Dwarikanath Ganguly, whose second wife was Dr. Kadambiri, the first woman doctor of India who had graduated from England. So we see why I am telling you all this, to know that the wonderful lineage Satyajit Ray came from. Now we come to Satyajit Ray. As we all know, he was born 1921, 2nd of May, in Calcutta. And he was brought up by his mother, Suprabha Devi. From the very beginning, he inherited the qualities of his father and his grandfather. For example, he was very good at drawings. He had interest in camera. He has interest in science. He has interest in history. He has interest in Indian culture. His interest in satire. He had interest in seeing films or writing some satirical pieces for the benefit of the common man without being controversial. So we found the third generation from Upendra Kishore, Shukumar and then Satyajit, he started excelling. Of course, fatherless, he had very faint memories of his father because he was only two when he lost him. In one of his recollections, he recalls that his last memory of his father was they had gone to some place which is now in Jharkhand for a holiday, and a train was moving, and then father was telling his young son, 2-year-old son, look, that is a train. The train was embedded in Satyajit Ray's mind, and we later see that in many films trains play a very crucial role that will come later. So Ray started growing up, and his friends included very select people with whom he would like to talk about films, the dramas, the literature, Tagore, Bankim, and everything, anything intellectual. This was one side of him. He went to Presidency College and he was very popular there. He was a favorite student of his professors. He was very tall, 6 feet 4.5 inches, and made good friends. And some aspect I discovered much later, which perhaps is not known to many, that he was a cricketer of excellence also. And he was a spin bowler, he was a spinner. That perhaps helped him in spinning stories for his detective and other fictions. But he was very popular. But keeping in view his family traditions, who had great interest in arts also. And it is said that Tagore Gurudev, who was then at the helm of Shantiniketan, wanted Shukumar's son to study in Shantiniketan. So 1940, he goes to Shantiniketan to study fine arts. And who is his teacher? The famous painter, Acharya Nandalal Bose. Under his tutelage and guidance, he started excelling in drawing. Some finer tips were given by Nandalal Bose, like, for example, drawing a tree. The valuable advice would come that don't draw the tree from top to bottom, because the tree grows from bottom to top. So you start from there. These helped Ray in shaping his or honing his skills as an artist, which we find in copious quantity in his films, the sketches, the paintings, the drawings. I don't think he was particularly happy or content in Shantiniketan because his mind was always focused on making films. And there in Shantiniketan, he studied sculpture. He was influenced by Rodin, the statue of the thinker. Then other filmmakers, say Kurosawa of Japan, and then Jean Renoir of France, and then Eisenstein of Russia, who had made some very good films. So he was always influenced by them. There were two more legends who had influenced him. One was Keaton, another Lloyd. Let me also tell you that Eisenstein, that is Sergei Eisenstein, had made a wonderful film in 1944, almost at the same time when Satyajit was studying in Shantiniketan, Ivan the Terrible. And one more film, which is of repute, I am unable to recollect that. So, we find that a very deep influence of the Western filmmakers, thinkers, sculptors had taken Ray by, if I may say, by a storm. Means he was greatly influenced by them. But at the same time, he studied Ajanta, Ellora, the Kailash there. And very importantly, he made trips to these places. He visited Ajanta, Ellora at a very young age and Kailash. And during, when he picked up full-time writing other than cinema, so we find in his detective stories, some stories rotated around Ajanta, Ellora, he's going to Aurangabad, trying to solve a mystery and everything. Well, after 2 years, he returns to Calcutta from Shantiniketan, and then he joins a British ad firm, which is known as DJ Kemmer, K-E-Y-M-E-R. There he worked for some time. They asked him to prepare some logos, write some captions, innovate some ideas about sale of perfumes. So with his immense creativity, Ray contributed a lot in the growth of the ad firm. He was there for a very short time, but they were very happy with him as an Indian, and his drawings, still preserve some, were par excellence. And they named him privately the Orient Long Man, because he was quite tall, as I told you, he was 6'4 plus. By the time, I will come to his personal life again, because we are discussing his life and times. At age 18, he fell in love with a cousin of his. Cousin in the sense that his mother's half-brother's daughter, that is Bijoya. And they courted for a long time before they got married in 1948. Satyajit married Bijoya when Satyajit was 27 years old. The common interest shared between Bijoya and Satyajit was the interest in camera. And Ray was already nurturing his ideas of making a film. He had seen German films, and I just recounted few names of the Western filmmakers. So he was wanting to make some film. Now here we see a great blend of his, that he was influenced by the West, but he also kept himself abreast with the writings of the Indian authors, which hit him, struck him. And we see many of his films were from the Indian authors. They were based on him. including his grandfathers, his own, Tagore, Premchand, and everything. When we discuss his films, we'll come to that. So, after his marriage in 1953, a son was born named Sandeep. Still there, he assisted Ray in many, many, many films as a cameraman, as an assistant director. And these days, he's carrying forward the Ray legacy, the fourth generation representative of the Rays in producing films, directing films based on Ray's short stories, detectives, fictions, mysteries, very interesting, very popular. The Feluda stories, Feluda is the detective, as you all know, Pradosh Mittir. So the legacy goes on. It is very difficult to replace a gigantic figure, Satyajit Ray, whose centenary we are discussing now. But at least that legacy is on. And Sandeep's wife, Lalita, is also with him in this teamwork. Bijoy Ray passed away long back, but she was also steadfastly behind Ray in his journey, making films and everything throughout. The certain characters or the strong points, forte or USPs of Ray, whatever you call it, I will just list out some. Many of you know, but still it is worth reiterating. Number one, that he was a great photographer. No denial of that. Absolutely genius photographer. Photographing from different angles, from a moving train, from a stationary train, from the hilltop. In 1962, he made Kanchenjunga. There you find that his Darjeeling, the train is going, or the hills, high hills, whether it is Kanchenjunga, of course, as the name says, the peak, all kind of things. Number two is sketches. He was a unique film director, at least in India, who was capable of drawing with wonderful sketches. And it would be very easier for him, very handy, to hand over his cast that you, here is, say, in Gopika in Baghabind or in Shatranj Ke Khiladi or anything, these are the characters, you have to play this role. So entire, if Shomitro is acting or Uttam Kumar is acting, he would draw them. Somebody is carrying an umbrella, that was his great thing. Absolutely original, innovative, absolutely unalloyed. Very, very like a pure gold, he would do this. Then, very importantly, I must bring this up, is his scientific temper. You know, everywhere his theme would rotate around science, the reasoning, and against any kind of superstition, whether it is religious or social or anything. There was no caste barriers. Perhaps through the powerful medium of cinema, he wanted to give a message that we should be above all these things. That perhaps is the India he was dreaming of. And we see such reflections in his films. So, the scientific temper is also seen in his films when he's trying to explain, say, some wildlife or say, some plants or some human beings or anything. So, there's plenty of that almost in every film. Then, his sense of humor, very subtle, and humor he always considered that without laughing himself, he would make others laugh and they would carry a plenty in his films. Another USP or a strong point of his was a very keen observer. He was not the one who would go around for addas and, you know, when all the Bengalis at that age would write romantic poems and everything, Ray would be involved in studying films and how to improve, how to improvise, how to give a message to others. This is a different kind, all this. This kept adding up in the list of his personal qualities. Then another thing is his great capacity for talent spotting. He would not go in his caste, for his caste, for glamour or any kind of glitter. Absolutely black and white character, simple character, may not be very handsome, may not sport a mustache or a beard or anything. Whatever the character suits, he would tailor accordingly. Huge talent spotting, whether he has to pick up a widow. And it is said that he, say for example, Jaya Bahaduri, he picked up for Jaya's first film in 1963, which was Mahanagar, Jaya Bahaduri. So he used one of his comedians, Robi Ghosh, who was pally with Jaya's father, Tarun Bahaduri, that can I get that girl for my film? He may have seen her in some film or some magazine or something. So then went there, he sat in his car, Jaya was brought with Tarun Bahaduri, contacted. Similarly, other films also, he would go to the coffee house, send his film. So great observant and a talent spotter. That credit must be given. I'm not trying to say that other film directors in India and Bollywood or Hollywood or anywhere, they are not Tollywood, but he was a cut above the rest in these things. We know that. And that is how we see, say in 1961, he made Abhijan. He chose Wahida Rehman opposite Shomitro. Both were very young then. And Shomitro was given a role of a Hindi speaking man. Whether he would fit with Wahida, who had already made a name in CID, in Pyasa, and other films. But no. He would cast the person for whom the role is tailored or he thinks that it fits the bill. That was real in his talent as well. Another thing is his patience or his keen eye for the children. In many films we find, Enjoy Baba Phelunath or Aguntuk or Pathar Pachali, anything, a lot of children talent he had tapped. He had harnessed the best from the children and he had displayed immense patience in directing them in every film. How to Walk, I've seen some of the documentaries when it's run up to his film. So he was extremely patient and he would always persevere to bring up the best from the child artist. And that was Ray. You know, ordinarily we will find a director of that stature would lose cool or lose patience and will ask that I will not take you. He had made specific movies also for the children, for different foreign countries also. He has made, say, Piku for the French television, a small, yes, a Photik Chand for that matter, for the children. So how to make it the films interesting for the children, that was his. These are some of, at random, some qualities of where he excelled as a complete all-rounder. And the last, his command over music. When he made his first film in 1955, Pathar Panchali, the music he had asked Ravi Shankar to score music, second again Ravi Shankar, third again Ravi Shankar. Then in one movie of 1961 or 62, he called Ustad Vilayat Khan to score the music. Basically, I see that instrumentalist, sitar and sarod, and they were brought in. But then he found, as it is also recounted by his wife in her autobiography, Vijaya Ray, that we find that he found it very difficult because Ravi Shankar, etc., were making forays into the Western world, making names, though he was in his mid-30s or late-30s. So he started composing music himself. and late 60s till his last movie, Agantuk, in 1991-92. And in other movies, documentaries, anything, he scored his own music. So the list of qualities I just rattled out included his capacity to compose music also. So that brings an end to his life and times. I have randomly selected 4 films of Satyajit Ray to discuss. Pother Panchali, made in 1955, then Shonar Kella, 1974, Shatranj Ke Khiladi, 1977, and last film of Ray, that is Agantuk, which was finished in 1992, the same year that Ray passed away. So, in all, he had made 28 feature films. In addition to that, he had made several documentaries, one on his father, one on Tagore, one on Sikkim, and on him also film was made. Then he had made some short films also, Premchand, Sadgati, Om Puri, etc. Then some all. But overall, substantive feature films, 28. So, Pother Panchali, many of you know, he was very young when he made, and always he had a dream to make films. He was hit, as I told you, that he had an influence of the Western thinkers, but he chose to make a film on a story written by Bibhuti Bhushan Bandyopadhyay, the Pother Panchali. Poth, the road, Panchali is a tale of a short road. It hit him. It did show poverty, but perhaps he wanted to, without any malintent, show the realities of life. And he was, what, he was hardly any age when he made it. He had run into great difficulty in making his debut film. He had no money. He had pawned his wife's jewelry. None of the producers came forward to help him because he had inexperience. But he had confidence in himself. He had quit studies, he had quit advertisement job, everything. And he wanted to make a film. So his entire investment was to Pother Panchali. These constraints notwithstanding, he was able to complete the film. He had shot at a place called Boral, where he shot the entire thing. And very briefly, it was a story of a very poor family with 2 children who were growing up, the siblings. So in that novel, perhaps the story perhaps was powerful, but the cinema lent a lot of credence to that work of Bibhuti Bhushan Bandyopadhyay. That is the magic of Pother Panchali. Number one, the poverty. Number two, the love between the siblings, the brother and a sister. Sister was elder, and an old widowed aunt of the owner of the house, how she is struggling and not enough for 2 square meals. Through the films, this is projecting wonderful. The lack of response from relatively more affluent relations and neighbors, how the children are deprived of their growing up, lack of adequate clothing, food. And mind you, many of you must have noticed that when the film made quite a news and headlines in the Western circles, in India, Nargis, who had already, the actress, who had already made a name for herself in Aag and other films, and Chori Chori was being made in 1955, complained and sort of made a blistering attack on Ray, that why is this film made to expose the Indian poverty and the Indian have-nots in the Western eyes. But there were takers also other than the West. Pandit Nehru, the Prime Minister, he loved it. His young daughter Indira Gandhi then, she was very friendly to Satyajit Ray and she also endorsed it. So it gained currency not only in Bengal, all over India. The Western remarks were very forthcoming that the film was quite a hit. Say, those days it was not a box office hit, but in terms of art, in terms of presentations, in terms of photography, in terms of music, in terms of direction, I would say Ray getting into the minutest details of this film was the hallmark. Say, for example, there is a bioscope wala who is going around in the village and the children have no money to see, others are seeing it. So what is the psychology among the children? And the novelist may not have necessarily taken this aspect into account, but that did not escape Ray's genius, who showed them wonderfully. And the father, who was more sort of liberal with the children, with money, he's going out. The sister is telling the brother, go and ask some money from the father so that we can pay. And they are seeing through that, Dilli ka Kutub Minar dekho, Lal Kila dekho, those games. So these are some of the things which was great observation of Ray. And he put it in the film. Bullock cart is carting the luggage of the person. The details about that, the wheels. Initially, it appeared to many that it was a very slow movie. It did not gain momentum, but it was able to show the realities. Say, for example, the children, the thrill in them in getting the sight of the train, a moving train, a steam engine, billowing smoke, going far away from their house, they are watching with awe through the small orchard. They're watching and they're talking about this train. When the daughter, who is gravely ill under treatment because she caught a cold, she's telling her brother that once I recover, we'll go again to have a look at the train. So the train, and there I bring back, perhaps this is my research, that Sukumar had shown about the train or told his 2-year-old, so that what it means, the train was always there. So Pathik Panchali, we found that the cast was very intelligently chosen and the minute details very, very well shown. We also know what was the type of society that existed then between the affluent. But this picture was surely the beginning of Ray in India as a successful filmmaker, touching the most minute aspects of a human life through the story and reaching out to the millions of viewers. That way, Pathik Panchali was a great success, and then Ray never looked back. So this was quite a hit. Another film other than Pathik Panchali, which I'm going to discuss or touch upon, is Sholar Kella or the Golden Fort. As I told you that Ray had great interest in history, in science and everything. So he sort of, instead of pure fantasy, he made this film. This was a very low budget film, but the cast was quality wise very good. Shomitro as the hero or the detective, his nephew Topshe, and then Santosh Lal Mohan Ganguly as Jatayu. These are some of the characters in Feluda stories there. And then some of his old team members like Kamu Mukherjee, Shailen Mukherjee, etc. So there I told you about the scientific temper. He's talking about parapsychology. He's talking about reincarnation. He's talking about a child who had in his previous life had dreamt of seeing Sonar Kella, which is now in Jaisalmer. So how he reaches? Then there is hypnosis also. He goes to a hypnotist who tries to analyze. So all kind of these scientific things make the whole thing very interesting in the film. And I also told you about the realities in the film, but Ray is there, and the scientific temper once again. Is that, say, for example, in a Jodhpur circuit house, he is showing a scorpion inside a jar. So Ray, through his film, through the dialogue, through the script, is telling the children to the crowd that scorpion's potency of the venom, how it paralyzes the nervous system. This is an education, though it is not a documentary film, but through the feature film also is sending messages. Then the camel in the desert, he is showing how a camel stands up, how a camel sits, using his forelegs and hind legs, when is it used? It is based on knowledge and pure knowledge. Then again, train comes in here. The wonderful photographic skills are noticed when nighttime photography is done inside a moving train. And mind you, in 1974, the cameras were still primitive. And in India, and in Ray, who made low budget films, he had no money. And those days, you know, the filmdom was, I would say, impoverished in these terms. But he made it. Faint light, blue light, moving train through the deserts. And he filmed it very successfully. And the realistic thing what I talk about, Ray, is the train is moving, say, from Kanpur to Jodhpur or Jaisalmer. So he would not show Kanpur board and then suddenly they reach Jaisalmer. The train moves through the station. In Kanpur, the detective and his team, or the hero and his team, they enter into the compartment. The coolie comes, the coolie is shown, money giving is shown, a Marwari fellow traveler is eating. Typically the way they eat inside the train, the food does not finish. Then the Bengali actors, they are trying to speak, the detective whose mother tongue is Bangla is trying to speak Hindi to impress the fellow passengers. These are some of the things that are so well woven in the story that it makes the film wonderful. And it was very interesting to see when I went to Jaisalmer later, it is no longer called Jaisalmer ka Kela and all. Everybody refers to it as Sonar Kela because Ray had popularized it. In a way, he had promoted tourism also. Other than this, Tagore's nephew, Abanindranath Tagore, had written a Raj Kahini, which speaks about all the Rajputana states and forts and all. But in the film, glorifying the fort, what it was, and through all the things of, say, hypnosis, the detective, how a plot thickens and how it is solved, the mystery is solved, how everything. Those are very well depicted in Sonar Kela. I mean, if you have seen it, fine. If not, then I would say that you must see that. It will be very interesting. We still watch Sonar Kela whenever we get time and never get bored. The third film I am coming to is Shatranj Ke Khiladi, or The Chess Players. You all must have seen this. It was a very popular short story by Premchand during the annexation of Awadh in the later half of the 19th century, when Wajid Ali Shah was ruling. Quite a hit movie, colored. Why I have chosen Shatranj Ke Khiladi? There's no doubt the Premchand story is very powerful, the characters, the theme. But Satyajit Ray's casting of people there, one would surprise, but yet he was able to extract the best out of them. Say, for example, Wajid Ali Shah. He picked up Amjad Ali Khan, who had played Gabbar barely 2 years ago in Sholay. He was seen as a criminal, as a murderer, as a heartless, cruel fellow. His chopping of the hands of Sanjeev Kumar. But he chose him to play the role of Wajid Ali Shah. And he did a wonderful job in that. The absolutely wonderful directions when he is sitting in his throne. And then the Britishers want to annex it on some pretext or the other. So he is holding his throne like this. And the camera focuses on his hands. You might say that what is so great about it. But yes, he went into these details. Then again coming back to casting Wajid Ali Shah's mother, played by Veena, who had hardly played such roles except Hindi films. She had played the roles of a vamp. But her flow, her direction, pleading with the British not to annex Awadh. The allegations of malgovernance was bad. So Ray brought the best out of Veena also. Why only Veena? Outram, he was a Scotsman who was the regent then. Satyajit Ray flew into London to contact Richard Attenborough, the maker of Gandhi. Gandhi was not made then. It came to the world in 1982, 5 years after Shatran Ke Khiladi. But Satyajit Ray had talent, spotted him. And for his ADC's role, he had picked up Tom Walter, who was fluent in Urdu. And he got his the ADC's uniform stitched in a London tailor. Look at the details. He could have ignored that, asked any Bollywood or Calcutta tailor shop to give it, and any Angrez, any Firang to fit in. But no, he wanted to make it in. The way Outram in real life used to smoke his cigar, Ray got him rehearsed, the accent, his pertinent questions, what is a Muharram, Tom Walter is interpreting because he was conversant in Urdu. These are some of the things very beautifully portrayed. Again, two other main cast, Sanjeev Kumar. His role in Sholay again 2 years ago was of a different, Thakur Baldev Singh talking with a different kind of voice. And here, he is one of the Nawabs who is immersed in playing chess, oblivious what his wife is doing, whether she's entered into any extramarital out of boredom or whatever. So he brought the best out of Sanjeev Kumar, playing on a Shatranji and playing. Saeed Zafri, he was again brought from London to play the role of another Nawab who was playing opposite Sanjeev Kumar. Of course, he had an advantage. His mother tongue was Urdu, he was chaste, and he spoke Lakhnavi Andaz ka Urdu, so he was very this thing. But to polish all the actors and actresses, whether it is Shabana Azmi or Leela Mishra or anybody, he got them rehearsed, or a dying old man Aga of yesteryears. You see the film again, and what I have said, you find that so much of heart and soul was put together by Ray to make it successful. Then finally, the language, the Audhi. How come in the story we don't find that so much of Audhi is spoken? Because it's in Hindi or it's in Urdu. But a small child is going, ki hum tohre liye khana le aavat hai, kawab chowk se kawab paratha laega. Ye gora paltan ka lal rang humka bada bhavat hai. These are some. Wherever he thought that it was not his domain, it was not his turf, like speaking of the or the Lucknow culture and everything, he would immediately fall back upon an authority on the subject or somebody who is acquainted with that. Say, for example, for Shatran Ke Khiladi, he hired Sri Lal Shukla, the famous Hindi author of Raag Darbari, and asked him to guide him on Lucknow. He was an UP cadre officer, he was familiar in it. So he, as a team, he took everybody together, whether it is costumes, photography, humor, chess, history, voiceover Amitabh Bachchan. how the British in between intermittently he's speaking in Shatranj ke Khiladi. So it was absolutely fantastic. I mean, I can speak for hours together on this, whether it was dialogue or anything. It was absolutely very lively film made, and it sort of, I'm a fan of Premchand, but this film has made me understand Premchand's message in a much better way. So now I come to the last film of his, that is Agantuk. Agantuk is written by, was written by Ray. Original name was Atithi, or the guest, but then it was in the film he made it Agantuk, anybody, a visitor or an arrival. So it's about Utpal Dutt is there, who is thought to be an uncle of the heroine, that is Mamata Shankar. And the whole theme arouses a very significant human aspect, that is the trust. Whether the visiting uncle, the Agantuk or the Atithi, is an imposter, he is sort of, or he is a fake or something, who sends a letter then arrives. So how the Mamata's husband, that is Dipankar Day, who has acted in this film, a very famous Bengali actor, he tests him. And in the absence of his own capacity to test him, he brings his intellectual friend, that is Dhritiraman Chatterjee, who engages him in a long drawing room conversation where they talk for hours together. And through this conversation, he is saying about the tribal culture, about indigenous people, about the importance of being a wanderlust, or how it is so bad to be a frog in the well, Koopamandak, he says, to come out. So Ray has a very, very strong message to give, that come out of the shell, go out and visit places. There is so much of tribal culture, indigenous culture available here. Mamata Shankar, Uday Shankar's daughter, who has acted as a heroine in this film, is a famed dancer. So to show the tribal dance, the Southal dance, he takes Mamata Shankar there and makes her dance also. So in 1 or 2 hours, some minutes film, he is able to show, package it in such a way that there is never a dull moment in that film. That is the beauty of it. Then I discussed about his directing the children and the science. Utpal Dutt takes the child, the son of Mamata Shankar and Dipankar Day, to the Maidan near Victoria Memorial in Calcutta. There is telling him about science, how an eclipse takes place. So he takes out his coin and showing everything. So what is it? The message, like I discussed about Shonar Killa, about scorpion camel, it may appear very naive to many of you, but certainly not. He's trying to give it what is important, and through the children he's using it. Because this is a film, in other films also, say Joy Baba Pelunath, Utpal Dutt again, children, Shomitro, almost the same cast. They are also against religious superstition, and lot of science is brought up. This, I find, has always been a very strong point of Satyajit Ray's films. So these were the four films I want to discuss. Now we are coming towards the end of my presentation. And last, I will finish by paying tribute to Ray on his birth centenary today by sharing a personal anecdote of him, which has nothing to do with his films, but shows his character, how great he was, not as a humanist, so magnanimous, and above all the pettiness, not for cheap popularity or anything. I was working in the Prime Minister's security, and Mr. Narasimha Rao was the Prime Minister, and I was sent when Satyajit Ray was unwell. He was admitted in a Calcutta hospital, which was Bellevue Nursing Home, under the care of one Dr. Bakshi. I'm telling these facts to just to elaborate on that. And I had gone in advance, tied up with the Calcutta police, and Narasimha Rao was coming from Shantiniketan with his family 8, 9 children, grandchildren and everybody to see Ray and how he was doing, inquire about his well-being. But Ray, the hospital was full of pipes and everything. I was not well, so I told his wife and the doctor and everybody whether Prime Minister wants to come for 5 minutes, whether it is okay. They said okay, it was 5 minutes without disturbing, it is okay. And then Prime Minister sent a message to me that he would like him and his whole family photographed with Ray. A lying Ray with all under treatment, with all kind of pipes and medical equipments in his nostrils. The doctor did not take a decision. He passed it to his wife, Mrs. Vijaya Ray, who in turn passed it to Satyajit. And he said that, well, no photography to be allowed. Prime Minister can come, meet me, wish me. I will also thank him, but no photography. So, but Prime Minister, while returning through his helicopter journey from Shantiniketan, he kept a pressure through his security and telling it to me, conveying to me that under no circumstances, because I am coming with my family and it's a historic one-time opportunity that I will get snapped with him, so it must be. But Mr. Ray was Mr. Ray. He had a very firm no, and then comes, walks in Prime Minister with some of his children and grandchildren, total 8, 9. The cabin is closed, and then he says, Mr. Ray, I would like to be photographed. My 3, 4 generations who are here, they have been fans of yours, they have been seeing pictures of yours. So, my photographer is here, you can photo. Then he indicated his nostrils to be removed so he could speak properly. So, if I can't produce ad verbatim, but based on my recollections, he said, Mr. Prime Minister, in his own baritone voice, while I appreciate that you have come all the way from Delhi to inquire about my health, all these days I am in the hospital, I have been denying permission to the West Bengal, Calcutta local photographers who have been trying to snap me in this condition. It will be very unfair and unjust on my part if we allow the Prime Minister's photographer to snap my photo with you. I am extremely sorry for that, Mr. Prime Minister. I can't accede to this request. Then he put back his nostrils and started breathing. So that was the character of that man who had the guts to tell the Prime Minister, and for a cause, because he didn't want to. He could have allowed him easily, yes, Prime Minister, you can come as many shots as you want. But he did not do that, because his own photographers, his own in the sense that all those who have been waiting for the last fortnight or 1 month to take a glimpse were not allowed, so that perhaps Ray considered that was a breach of privacy. He did not allow them. And this time to Narasimha Rao also was firmly entrenched. He was Prime Minister for almost 1 year by then, firmly in position. But he said no. That was Ray, the great Satyajit Ray. So that brings to an end to my presentation. And thank you very much for your patience in listening to me. And once again, I join you all in extending my centenary birthday wishes to late Sri Satyajit Ray. Thank you very much.